Hey.
That was so close.
Shooting domes.
I feel a little better about using it because I've already whacked on it once.
Welcome, subscribers, new viewers. If you're just tuning in with us, if you've been here since 2011 now, welcome to what I hope to be the definitive review of the ESLT. This is not going to be an open the box and shoot it for 2 minutes review. We don't do that here, sorry. This is going to be a nice long review of every little thing on this blaster. There's a lot to go over. It's been around for a while, and I'm here to maybe dispel some myths, maybe prove some. I don't know. Sit back for the ride, and let's get right into it. ESLT, designed by Ryan McNumbers of Mostly Harmless Arms, way back in the period of 2013, early 2013. And since then, it has gone through a ton of design changes, as we will see here. Thank you to Drev from Nerf Haven for loaning me his, and to Snoop Doggy Doge from Nerf Haven for loaning me his for the purposes of this review. And the blue one is my personal ESLT, which I bought as a customer from Mostly Harmless Arms, full price. Thank you to my subscribers who don't use Adblock, and for everybody viewing this as well. We purchased this with ad revenue. So I can review this review honestly. This represents kind of the original model, and these two here are, I'm going to call them the 1.6s. I think that's what Ryan calls them. So these are the most up-to-date, the pink and the blue. The green is not as much. The green was also a home build, which we'll get into a little bit later, but I'm going to go over all the variants here too, because that's kind of important in the versatility of the blaster. Design. Pretty simple. We have a tube up here, which is connected to your pump grip, pushes back on a steel rod, which is connected to your plunger. When you push back on here, the air from this plunger goes forward. There's an O-ring here, which is supposed to stop it or seal it, so it doesn't go straight out the front. It goes up and around and then through the Y when you actually pull the trigger. Trigger operates like a submachine gun catch, that's what I call it. You have one lever that pops up here, and then the trigger itself pulls down on it, so that's actually what fires it. Overall, incredibly innovative design. 11 out of 10 on this. I cannot stress this enough. This is amazing. Mostly Harmless Arms does some really innovative stuff when they want to. That's really good. Again, a floating plunger head on that piston, so that little black piece moves back and forth with that plunger head. You see it there. Theoretically, it creates a good seal when moving forwards like this, but actually opens up two holes in the plunger tube right there when it's moving backward. So the idea is you don't vacuum load darts or get a dart here and then pull back when you pump back. It doesn't come with any kind of stop behind the PVC. Why? I added one on Snoop's because I found that even so, they still jam. If you rack this thing back really fast, even with little holes in there, there's still going to be some kind of backflow here. So I like to put that little nail in there anyway, because when these things jam, they do jam. And I'm using like lower caliber ammunition, slightly thinner than the pink foam that MHA uses. So even with that, it's still will occasionally jam, maybe once a war, but bring some 3/8 inch dowel with you that's at least, you know, a foot and a half long, because nobody ever seems to have one of those dowels, and it would make life a whole lot easier. That's design. Let's get right into ergonomics. Basically, I'm going to start with this guy here. Hold it this way, because I am right-handed. The pump grip. Pump grip is interesting. On the backstroke, it's very comfortable, or fairly comfortable at least, because you have this angled surface pulling back to you. On the forward stroke, whoops, nothing really to catch on to. So one of the little quirks of the ESLT is you have to grip that pump nice and tight, which ends up being a benefit when you actually go to shoot it. Something you have to watch out for, though. And one other thing you'll notice about the pump and you'll see this a lot in my in the shooting videos I'm rolling in, is that I'll adopt kind of like a vertical foregrip here when I'm holding it, or back here. It feels just a little far out there, especially with everything else being so together back here. It's a little weird, it's a little quirky, but could I get around it? Yeah. Would I prefer a different style of pump? Honestly, yes, I still would. It's not bad, but that's just me. Getting back to a little bit of my first encounter with the ESLT. This is Snoop's ESLT. He upgraded his a bit. I upgraded it initially, but this pump grip at APOC snapped right at the screws. Why is that? Well, because the pump is printed with this as the bed, and then it's printed up from 3D printing. So you have your layers oriented like this. You have your stress points pulling a force in directions like this, laterally. Can you see why that is a problem? You are pulling those layers apart every single time you prime this blaster. That's a little bit of a design flaw. Is it a game changer for me? Not really. I've had this one since June, and it hasn't done anything. Maybe you just barely see some of those stress marks now, but it doesn't look like it's going to crack on me. If it does, I'll let you know. But so far, it's good. It could be better. This is how Drev got around it. I think this is how the original ones were. Instead of being a 3D printed ABS, you have a solid PVCT, an injection molded PVCT, which isn't going to break on you, no matter what kind of load you put on it. I think this is superior in terms of durability. It's going to add a lot of weight, though, because that's an injection molded part. A compromise would be, and this is if you're doing your own modifications to it, enter the PCSR, would be to have your injection molded or extruded piece being the load bearing component, and then to add a 3D printed part for ergonomics. So that main stress is not borne by that piece, but instead by this. My solution to it. That's all it is. Moving back, we have the receiver here with the trigger and handle. Let's talk about the handle first. This was Rev 1. This is 1.6. So 1 versus 1.6, they've come a long way from this old blocky thing. It looks more like a handle now, whereas before, I don't even know what this is. It wasn't very good. Is this still good? You know what? When I first felt it, I tell you no. It didn't feel that great to me, but you know what? When you use it, you don't notice it. It's a much better handle, much more improved than it was originally. Maybe I would prefer a slightly smaller roundness here, or slightly smaller radius, but you know what? Good job, Mostly Harmless Arms. Big improvement, and you don't feel it when you're using it. That's all I need. It works. The trigger. Little bit of a bash here. This is what it looks like originally. It's this big boat oar right here. It feels funny when you try to pull on it. You can only get the very, very tip of your finger on it. To me, it's not very good. Big, fat, long pull. So, as you can see on the ones that I've modded, or that I've played with, you have more trigger-like triggers. I much prefer that. Ryan, if you're watching this, I will give you the files if you really want that. Stock is another thing here. The original stock looks much more like this. Looks like it should be supporting a bridge, right? Well, the other part of that is it's very comfy when you have it against your shoulder, and this is not the original stock. This is, again, a Drev build. The actual stock from Mostly Harmless Arms is a big black piece of foam, solid foam, not this corrugated stuff here. Very comfy against your shoulder. But do you see a problem with this? You put your face right here. And the reason I changed mine out is because I would whack my face right on this inadvertently. I'm a runner. I don't like to stand still when I nerf. So, not very often, but sort of inexplicably, that would end up happening for me. Maybe it's just like a training thing or getting used to it, but I just didn't like it. So I changed the stocks. This is my preferred method of stock here. It's more like, I guess you'd call it like the M4 if you want to be tactical or whatever. Feels alright. It's a little wide, but for me, that's not a big deal. face guard here. Snoop put some felt padding on the back, because if you have just bare plastic, I noticed at Frozen Foam 2, that would slide all over the place if you were wearing something like a leather jacket. Even that little bit of felt helps out a lot. So, these are my stocks, and that's just my take on it, my modifications to it. And you'll see that's kind of a theme. You can have three or four different ESLTs, and they're all going to be different. So everybody can add their little bit of personality. They're much like, again, like the AR-15 in gun culture, where you have them all over the place, and not one of them is going to be completely identical. And I think that speaks something to the community and something to the blasters themselves. But let's move on. I want to get through this. Ergonomics, we kind of just talked about. Ooh, one more thing. Length of pull. You'll probably notice that this blaster is very short, especially back here. Of course, I forgot my ruler, but I believe this length of pull is something like 11 inches from the tip of the trigger to the back of the stock. Typically, I like a longer length of pull, something like 14 inches. Did I notice it on this? Just like the handle. No, I really didn't notice it. In fact, when I was running around with it, I think it's kind of a benefit. You don't have that much swinging out when you're actually using it. So, if you're going to be running around and rushing with this, I think is a great way of using it, then yeah, the short length of pull is actually a benefit. Locks it right into your shoulder, and really not bad. Good job, Mostly Harmless Arms. Durability. Let's get to that. And this was where a lot of my initial bias came from. Snoop's handle cracked at APOC. That was in August. The first time it broke was at Frozen Foam 1, where the inside piece here actually broke. So you have a metal eye bolt in the inside connected to a 3D printed piece connected to a steel rod. Do you see the problem here? Your stress-bearing component is held together, tensile force, by a 3D printed part. The first game of the first war this blaster ever been to, it broke. So, to me, that was a huge, huge ding on this thing. And that's why I've waited so long for this review. I was like, you know what, if I'm going to give a negative review, I want to make sure I'm justified. I want to give this a fair review. And I'm glad I did. There's a lot of good things about this blaster, which I hope I'm convening to you right now. What else did I say? Oh yeah, screws need to be tightened. Bring one of these with you. Bring a screwdriver with you at the war. Because I will guarantee you that this screw right here, the trigger screw, is going to loosen up on you. And these two stock screws on each side are going to loosen up on you. That just will happen. Just from moving it around, the vibrations, it's going to happen. I guess we could tie this into ergonomics too. The original ESLT from the factory has an extension spring in it. Not really a huge issue, but when you fire this blaster, it sounds like, I don't know, it sounds like a gong. And you probably have been hearing this in the footage I've been rolling through, but it sounds like bong, bong, because you have a spring when you fire it, is stretched only like half an inch. It only has like half an inch of extra stretch, but it's just enough that I can still vibrate and still has resonance. So instead of the usual compression spring where it's always exerting its force on something, this one's being pulled almost like a guitar string. So that's just a little quirk if you're using the original ones. Is it good? Is it bad? I don't know. I don't think it's that big of a deal, but it's just something to keep in mind. Quality of parts. It seems like I'm wrecking on this thing a lot, but honestly, this is one of the big positives this thing has. I think Mostly Harmless Arms quality is very good. Let me bring this up a little closer and focus you in a bit. Come on. There we go. The slots here are very well done. They're better than 90% of my slots. The actual 3D printing is pretty good. I can't tell you what, you know, if that's 0.2 millimeters or 0.1 millimeters or whatever it is, but it looks pretty good. It's definitely there, the striations. but it seems high quality. It doesn't seem like a piece of crap. To get to that, I drilled directly through this receiver right here. Let me get you in the sunlight. To put on this cantilever mount that I put on aftermarket. I couldn't do that if it was just a two-layer thick print. It had to be thick. It had to have some meat to it. So the actual quality of the Mostly Harmless Arms parts, pretty good. In fact, very good. Good job, Mostly Harmless Arms. Range. And this is why... This was another big quip I had about this originally. They're all over the place. You can get a stock ESLT that will get, you know, I don't know, 75 feet. You're going to get low end. You're going to get like, I don't know, a not very good snap range. A messed up snap. A snap with a bad seal. But you can also get high-end rainbow ranges. It's all over the place. I'm not kidding at all. Because if you take a bungee and replace it and do some heavy modification to it, you can get this thing cranking. Some of the hardest non-compressed air, not 4Bs, that I've been hit with have been ESLTs. They just haven't been this. So don't think that this thing is a piece of crap, because it's not. You can do it, but don't expect it out of the box. If you're looking for like a 100-foot blaster, then look somewhere else, because this is not it out of the box. You have to do some modification to it. Weight. Oh, of course I didn't really measure this, but let's do this one. It's the closest to stock. Right now, this is... Zero you out. This is my grandma's meat scale. Thank you, grandma. This is 3 1/4 pounds. Add an extra 1/4 pound because of that original HDP stock. So 3 1/4 to 3 1/2 pounds. Is it the lightest thing out there? Heck no. Is it the heaviest thing out there? No, it's kind of middle of the road. Maybe a little heavier. It's going to be a little heavier than a snap without a sheath. Maybe about as heavy as a heavy rainbow with a sheath. So just to get that idea. It's very short. It's definitely under 3 feet. I'll roll it in there. But very short. Very carbine-like. Kind of like it for that reason. It's not bad, especially in short range, close quarters type of situations. So it's very versatile in that role. Let's get to versatility. Bungees and temperature. One of the comments I got on one of my ESLT or whatever, the PCSR, the competitor to the ESLT, was, oh, you put bungees in there and in warm weather, it'll do great. Big asterisks in warm weather. I will link a video description in the video description to another video, the Slingshot channel, where he has a slingshot that has a heated case around the bungees. And as soon as you compress that, you notice it loses energy, it loses heat, because energy is stored as heat. So in cold weather, even your bungeed ESLT will not perform quite as well. And, oh, well, that's not fair. Yeah, you're not going to nerf the other 6 months of the year? Like, give me a break. Give me the whole picture. That's just genuinely it. So, in the summer wars, yeah, this is great. But in the winter, you may need to tighten it up a little bit. Because you're going to lose some elastic energy with the bungee. With the steel spring, you're not going to see that much of a decrease in the energy. But with this particular compression spring, you don't have that much to begin with anyway. Just keeping it real, homies. Bungees and temp covered that. Modifications. Ton of modifications, as I just said. The ESLT is so overarching and expanding that you'll see all types. Here, Drev has the first version with kind of the low-profile mounts in the front and back. This is held in place with screws. The modifications I've done have obviously been with the stocks. You could see right there on Snoop's. The triggers, because I just didn't like the triggers. Flat out. Oh well. And on these, I put cantilever mounts. Why did I put cantilever mounts? Because, I don't know, the original ones came with a stock support that was held on by, I kid you not, a wrap of duct tape around the entire receiver here. Duct tape, in my personal, and again, my personal warring experience, began to pull itself apart at the very edges. Does it work? I mean, yeah, it works. I would much prefer something like this with two screws, but countersink those screws in the 3D printed components so you can actually not have metal hitting you in the face. God forbid someone gets hit in the face with this. But you have 3D printing ability. I mean, you can do whatever you want. What else? If you end up using the duct tape, just put some super glue on that so it doesn't come apart, because that did happen to mine. It just did. User serviceability. Ooh, this is not a great one. You can change the bungee tension once you actually have it in there. I'm trying to find which one has it. Yeah, it was Dread, wasn't it? But you have the bungees in the front right here. So you would basically take this, untie the bungees, pull it out a little bit farther if you wanted higher tension, and then just tie it tighter. Great. So that actually does work. That's a great one. The people with the highest powered ones always have the bungees. So I would say if you want range, bungee it up. But now we're getting into the meat of our conversation here. And ooh, we're already like 15 minutes in. Is this blaster worth it? It depends what you're looking for, because there are so many layouts that you can take. I'm going to move Drebs out of the way just for a second. There are so many layouts to this that you can take. You can leave it in its stock form, you can bungee it, and you can do all these other stuff to it. But how difficult is it to bungee? I've been told, oh yeah, field strip, you remove one screw, that's it. It's not that easy. Field strip, sure, remove one screw, and this is if you want to change it to a bungee, but you have to do a lot more than that if you want to just change it. The problem is, you take out this one piece, and you'll actually see it's fairly quick. Spring comes loose. Uh-oh. Closed slots. Have to take out these two pieces, too. So once those are out, you'll kind of see the internals a little better. And I've done this before, so as you can see, boom, very quick. They weren't lying. 30 seconds. Take that piece out. There you go. Ooh, and let's see that in there. That's the little culprit. So, you have inside there that little tiny hook eye. You gonna put a bungee through that? No, you have to take the whole thing apart, which I'm not going to do. You have to remove four more screws. You have to take the whole thing apart. You have to clamp the piece of steel rod that's behind it. And then you have to replace this with a larger one that will be able to hold your bungees. That's what I did in Snoop's. And am I going to keep this 3D printed piece when I do that? Absolutely not. Like I said in the first war, it broke the first game it was ever used in. You know what? I hope it's a fluke. I really do. Because these are good blasters, but I'm not going to lie to you and say that, oh, this is the most durable thing in the world. It's 3D printed on a major stress-bearing component. Replace it with this. It's nylon 6/6. If you've made rainbows or made ESLTs before, you have this. You just saw me take it out here. Instead of using a 3D printed component, use 2 extra inches of this. Thread that onto your steel. Thread that onto your eye bolt, and you'll be good to go. It'll never come apart on you. Get the square one if you want to like put it in a vise and tap it easier. That's just my 2 cents. Once you get that bigger eye bolt in there, though, then you could put the bungees on, and put the bungees on before you put this tube back in there. Otherwise, you'll be trying to snake it in and trying to get it through, you know, with a screwdriver and back out the front. Don't do that. It's a pain in the butt. Let's put this back together while we talk a little more about it. And that brings us to sort of the open source of it. Roles in War will be next. But we have, as you could see, Drev's blaster. He made that himself. That is a very noble thing of Mostly Harmless Arms to do. I'm very glad they did it, and it's the reason that so many people have this, I think. Because even if you don't buy it from Mostly Harmless Arms, Maybe you just wanted the build experience. There's nothing wrong with that. I'm kind of like that myself. So, good job, mostly harmless arms. I like that a lot. So all these parts are available, as I said, on Mostly Harmless Arms' website. Download them if you have a 3D printer. But you still need to buy that metal rod that I mentioned on the inside, or get a tap and die set for, I don't know, dozens of dollars. Maybe, I don't know how much they cost. But somehow you're going to need to tap just the back and just the front of that steel rod. There we go, finally got the spring hooked around that piece of nylon. Only took 10 minutes. Woo, all right. Rolls in war. And this, again, goes all over the place because of all the variants out there. If you get an ESLT stock from Ryan McNumbers, you have a short-range, high ROF blaster. One of my friends came to the war, and he said, wow, that looks like a great little carbine, something I might want. And that got me thinking, you know what? In the rolls in war of a close-range, dense-cover Blitz carbine, this is great. It's not that big. You can get an unmatched rate of fire, even from, like, rainbows or pump snaps, that kind of thing. Like, 4 darts a second? You see the footage. Something crazy like that.
Push up.
And that's why I see people that are wearing hoppers that are out to here on the thing. Because you can get off those 6 shots in under 2 seconds easy. It's not slam fire, but it doesn't matter. It doesn't need it. This is great because of that backwards grip on that pump. As long as you keep a tight grip on this, you can plug away. It's really good. If you have vertical foregrip, even better, I think. Other ways of using it. You can put the bungees in it, but again, you're sacrificing that rate of fire. You're going to get a little better range, but it's going to be much harder to pull it back and just pop to get them all off like that. It's not going to be the same carbine / like SMG roll that you had. Now you're getting into, it's going to be a little more like a rainbow. If you get some really heavy bungees in there, then yeah, it'll match a rainbow. I've seen it. I haven't done it myself. If you see someone rocking a really strong ESLT, ask them what they did to it. I'm not an ESLT expert. I have a lot of experience with them. I've done surgery on them. So definitely ask away when you see them, if you really want that. And this is another thing we're getting into. What's another role it has? It gets people interested in homemades. It's colorful. It's sexy. It is very similar to if Nerf themselves use PVC. This is what they would come up with. It has fairly ergonomic parts. It's not overly long. It's a familiar size. It doesn't have that big barrel sticking out the front like you would in a rainbow pump. It gets the new guys into the hobby a little bit. But when you are that new guy and you come to an NIC war, don't expect this thing to shoot with the 4Bs and with the rainbows. This thing will shoot better than a modified blaster, but less powerful than a good blaster. I think Kane wrote that on one of the posts I made. That's a valid statement. From the factory, they will. But if you want to mod it, and think about this, because it's different for every person. Is it worth it for you to spend $100 base just to go out and modify it if you're not going to have it working? Is it better to spend $50, half that, and build a good snap? I don't know. Will this have better ergonomics, better parts? Probably. So just like we were modding $30 blasters or $40 blasters from Nerf, now you're going to be modding $100 blaster for Mostly Harmless Arms, a homemade. Is that worth it for you? I don't know. Again, we all started out modding Nerf blasters.
Wait.
If you have a 3D printer, is it worth it? Let's say it costs roughly, you know, almost a whole roll, like 80%, 3/4 of a roll to make one of these. $30 is a roll. So is it worth it to spend $30 and then the extra $10 from Ryan McNumbers to buy that little inside piece, plus all the screws and all the extra hardware and all that stuff. So let's call it $50. Is it worth it for you to build this for $50, your time and energy? I don't know. Is it? Do you like building? Is this your hobby? Is this your pastime? Is this your passion? For Drev, it is. He loves doing this stuff. He built this on his own. So it really varies by person to person. If you want to do that, if you have the access to the 3D printer and all that, then sure, yeah, go for it. It's not a bad blaster in that philosophy. One other thing, indoor blaster. I took this to NY Dart Zone right here on Long Island 2 weeks ago or so. They're in Suffolk County, Long Island. And I noticed this one here running stock internals. It was basically perfect. It's not a huge indoor airsoft arena. It's rather small compared to like a lot of the outdoor wars we have. But it is, once again, dense cover. You don't have the air blowing one way or the other on you. And short range. I can hit from one wall to the other using one of these, no problems at all. If you're using this with like a heavily modified strife or something like a rapid strike in an indoor situation, this will be awesome. Because now you're kind of matched up with everybody else. So it will actually be pretty good. I think that's a great calling for it that a lot of people don't really realize. But I noticed it was perfect. So if you had a room full of ESLTs, stock ESLTs at least, I think this is a little overpowered for an indoor war. This would be pretty good. What else? Oh, before we go, something to take on, I guess, if you're building this yourself. Notice that? This is Drev's. See that wobble? That is because we have a... Do I have it? Yeah. We have a flat item on a curved surface. So what's going to happen when you have something flat on something curved? That's right, it's going to rock. All the mostly harmless arms blasters also operate like that because they're printed from here up. So this is where the flat bed was on all of them. Has it been a problem for me? Nope, no problems. It's just something to think about. Is there a way to redesign this so it's curved, so it doesn't rock around? Maybe. But in the 6 months of fairly heavy use I've been using this, I haven't seen any wobble. The cantilever mount that I put on here, I drilled all the way through the receiver and put 3 screws in it. Would I be able to do that if this was only like 1 or 2 layers thick on the walls? No, I wouldn't. These are pretty high quality, even if they are 3D printed. I wouldn't have been able to do that. This would have just crumbled if I did that with like a 1 or 2 layer thickness. So that brings us down to value, and I think we've kind of been talking about it. Should you buy this blaster? If you're realistic in what it can do, then I think it's a pretty good blaster. I'm probably not even going to change this one. I'm probably leaving it with the spring. I can give this to a new person, and they kind of just get it. As long as you tell them to push the pump forward. It seems to be with new people, they just leave it like that, and oh, it's good. No, push the pump forward. I'm probably keeping it like this. It's a great loner blaster because, you know, you didn't do anything to it. It'll probably work on you. Despite this failure that Snoop had, again, it's still a 3D printed component on a stress-bearing surface. I don't like that. If I build one, I'm not using that. I'm not using that part. I'm going to do it myself and make it out of nylon. It's what it should have done from the original, from the start, I think. Is this a good blaster? Yes, but it's not a good blaster as a long range. It's a short-range Blitz carbine in its stock configuration. If you really want to mod it, then you might be able to get to the rainbow. But is it more worth it than just to get a rainbow without having to modify it? If you're a builder like me, maybe go ahead, go for it. If you have a 3D printer and you don't mind the caveats of everything that I just described, Mostly Harmless Arms has an excellent write-up on it on their website and also on Nerf Haven. So I hope I gave you the most in-depth review that I could on this blaster. I'm very glad I waited to review this because it has its place. It has a means of using it, but don't expect the world from it when you open it out of the box. Guys, this has been the definitive ESLT review. Thank you very much for watching. Leave all your questions, comments below, and I'd love to respond as quickly as I can. Have a great day. Nerf on. And